shoulder. That's been his reputation. I've always found him a nice guy to deal with, without wishing to spoil the stereotype too much.
Yeah, he always seems to come across quite well, but I don't know, he's forgot his cue. There's no when to come in.
Oh, he's on his way now. Thank you, Eamon. We did rather want to get on with the action. He's only been beaten twice in his career in 25 fights. Once against a big puncher in Teddy Reed. It was close in America. It was early in his career. The other one was an absolute robbery against Paul Berg, which he then avenged. He's a good puncher, ruthless on the counter, and that might be all in his favour, style-wise, against Ricky Hatton tonight. A lot of people think he'll beat Hatton, don't they?
Yeah, he's got good support. You know, he's a good quality fighter, Ian, right from his amateur days. This is the guy who's done it all. Silver medal at the World Juniors, right up. You know, should have went to the Olympics. Mad that he didn't get that opportunity. So he's proven himself time and time again.
And Hatton prepares to make his entrance.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, welcome your champion from Manchester, Ricky the Hitman Hatton.
And as always, the entrance is to the Manchester City theme song. One of the few luxuries in Hatton's life is that he has a hospitality box at his beloved main road. Well, we said when he started out, if you want a nickname like the Hitman, which Thomas Hearns had, you'd better be good. He's proved up to it so far.
Yeah, he's done everything that's been asked of him. He's come through a few scares with cuts, but he's doing it all. And the only fighter, I think, that can get this sort of crowd to come to a place like this. Really is a great buzz about Ricky Hatton and what he does in the ring.
As well, a modest, affable, boyish, down-to-earth man until he gets in a boxing ring.
Yeah, it all changes then for Ricky Hatton. He really is an all-action fighter. He goes in the ring to do nothing but get his opponent out of there, and I think that's what the crowd come to see. That's what he brings to the ring.
Who grew up idolising the great Roberto Duran. Like him, he is a wicked body puncher. He hasn't, of course, reached that kind of level yet. Indeed, quite a lot of independent assessors don't really think he's in the world top 10 yet. I think tonight is the litmus test. If he wins this and wins this well, I think he convinces a lot more people, and the story goes ever onwards and upwards. But yeah, it's an if, isn't it?
It is an if, and it should be a tough fight, but this will really put him up to the next level. This is the fight that he needs to really prove himself.
Tailor the tape for tonight's big fight, and a real big fight atmosphere too in Manchester. Hatton, still only 23, McGee 7 years older. Been waiting a long time for this. McGee is taller, has a reach advantage. He could make that count. Hatton was half a pound heavier, both inside the 10 stone light welterweight limit. Hatton a pro for 5 years and McGee for 7. A lower profile career for McGee. Something maybe that burns a little. He's seen Hatton get all the publicity. McGee's boxed a few more rounds. Hatton the better stoppage rate, though they're both very notable punches.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening once more, and welcome to the magnificent MEN Arena here in the city of Manchester, England. Tonight, Frank Warren Sports Network, in association with our main sponsors, Red Square, the drink that packs a punch, and the Vaughan Group, proudly present 12 three-minute rounds for the WBU Light Welterweight Championship. control steward in charge is Mr. Dennis Lawton. Timekeeper at the bell from Halifax in England is Mr. Colin Roberts. We have three scoring judges at ringside who are Des Bloy from Australia, Glenn Feldman from the United States of America, and Howard Goldberg from South Africa. Finally, when the action commences, the referee this evening, taking part in his 99th world title contest, is the one, the only, Mr. Mickey Van from Leeds, England. All right, fight fans, here we go. The time has come for the main event of the evening. 12 rounds of boxing for the WBU Light Welterweight Championship of the World. And now, ladies and gentlemen in attendance and boxing fans joining us around the world, live from Manchester, England, it is showtime! Introducing to you firstly, boxing out of the red corner, wearing his familiar green, white, and orange colored shorts. Underway in his scale, 9 stone 13 and 1/4 pounds, or 139 and 1/4 US pounds. He has an outstanding record, 25 contests, 23 wins, 18 of those wins coming by way of knockout with only the 2 defeats. He comes to the ring this evening as the former undefeated light welterweight champion of the Commonwealth and is the challenger for the championship from Belfast in Northern Ireland, presenting Eamon McGee. And opposing him, boxing out of the blue corner, wearing his familiar silver, blue, and black colored shorts. Underway, he scales 9 stone 13 and 3/4 pounds, or 139 and 3/4 US pounds. He has a perfect undefeated record, 28 contests, 28 wins, 23 of those wins coming by way of knockout. He is the former undefeated light welterweight champion of Great Britain, tonight making the 6th defense of his championship, Manchester, England. Welcome the WBU light welterweight champion of the world from this magnificent city of Manchester, England, Ricky the Hitman Hatton.
Can Hatton cope with McGee's precise counter-punching? How gung-ho will he be about it? Plenty of words swapped over the last couple of years between these two, though not too many this week. They've had good respect for each other. Both have prepared precisely and fanatically. Tempo might be a big thing in this fight as well. Hatton is a fast-paced fighter. Sometimes McGee has liked to take breaks. McGee does have a very good win, albeit a contentious one, over Shay Neary. Hatton tries to fight him, and he's caught by the counter, McGee! Oh, there was the danger, and he's down for the first time in his pro career. What drama within the opening minute. That's the danger. That's the danger for McGee. And what a lift. Hatton diving in, rushed it a little, and he was picked off by a wonderful shot. Well, goodness me, Glenn.
Yep, he has to take his time. He's rushing in. He's too eager to get close to McGee. McGee, good speed, got that counter in.
With terrific hand speed. Now, that's really going to make Ricky Hatton think. His head looks clear enough, but there's a sign of the danger. But he's going to have to be cute. Can't come in straight lines. McGee apparently has looked absolutely awesome in his sparring for this fight. Some say he knocked out Maxim Nestorenko, former European champion. There's the body shots, in and out tactics by McGee. Doesn't want to hang around in there, waiting for a counter. Take that, he says. This is the comeback from Hatton.
Yeah, that's what he needs to do. He needs to come straight back. to take the play back away from McGee. But he's got to keep that left hand up. Always been a defensive problem for Hatton.
Yes, he has been quite easy to hit in his career. He's always realised he'd have to take a few. It's just part of his style. It's almost a kind of Manchester Mexican style, to coin a phrase. There's the Hatton body shots again. McGee, very anxious not to hang around on those ropes. He says that Hatton has been beating blown-up lightweights and old men. Tonight he'll be in a rear fight, real fight. We've had an early sign of that again. He just looked a bit open, Hatton.
Yep, just taking a little while to get used to the southpaw stance.
Fire and brimstone already. There's the body shot again. Already some terrific action happened on the floor for the first time since Jürgen Bramer, the German, did it in the amateurs.
Completely. Right, I told you. We don't have to get anything just yet. We've got to be smart.
Well, that was not part of the plan for Ricky Hatton tonight, though. He knew there was a danger of it happening, all right.
Yep. He just pushed in a little bit too eager, too early to hit the penalty. Leaves himself open, trying to go for the left hook to the body, and then a sharp counter with that right hand puts him down for the first time in his professional career.
Significantly, not the left, the right.
Yep, well, it is Hatton's left hand that does come down. Look at it, he's going for his left hook, doubling it up, and then it's that right hand counter that gives them the problem.
Undoubtedly something they will have worked on in the sparring, because Hatton has looked open to right hands in his career. Well, you know what the song says, fools rush in where angels fear to tread. And that's what Hatton mustn't be doing, rushing in. Terrific start for McGee. But here comes more Ricky Hatton pressure, trying to deny McGee room to work.
Some good uppercuts and hooks to the body there from Hatton.
Oh, great right hand from Hatton there. 7 years, the younger man. There's two contrasting characters in this excellent light welterweight division. Lots of other talent around on the world scene too. Right uppercut from McGee. Good work from McGee. Hatton rather close in and then skips away again.
That's what he's got to be looking to do. Nice long right hand from Hatton. He's got to get plenty of angles, plenty of lateral movement in and out of range.
He's getting there with some of these body shots, Hatton. It's vicious, violent stuff from him as always, close in. One of the publicity handouts said that McGee had been hit by sticks in the gym to get him ready for Hatton's body shots. Whether that is just the invention of the publicist, I don't know. Good story.
Pretty close in there. Got to be careful when he's in there for cuts. That could be a problem. Another good right hand.
Oh, and a right too, and he looked a bit wobbled. Hatton on the inside there. Looks a bit wobbly. Left uppercut, and Hatton disorganized. And he's good at picking the shots, McGee. Hatton's in trouble and needs to hold on in a daze here. Anxious looks on the faces of his parents at ringside. One of the big crises in Hatton's career, maybe the biggest. I think McGee had him in a real daze for a few seconds there.
Yep, he definitely did, with a big right hand. Took a lot out of Hatton. Trying to find the angle for the body shots in there. But that's where he can leave himself open.
Very good left hook to the body. We thought McGee didn't like the body shots much when he fought John Thaxton in his last fight, even though McGee won that impressively in the end. So far he's coping with Hatton's attempted onslaught.
Nice little uppercut from Hatton, but the right hook was coming back from McGee.
This terrific action. Successes more for Eamon McGee,
tried,
really early.
You tried too hard to impress. There's still danger stuff coming back. Do you hear me? Come on. I'm claiming right away.
Nick Williamson, who's been hired in recent times because of his expert work with cuts. This was a problem many times for Hatton, but he's got five fights without getting a cut. This is the incident here now.
Big right hand there. That was the one that took it out of him. He tries to fall in, Hatton, to let his head clear. Mickey Bunt almost intervened there at a key moment, but it was a really good right hook from McGee. Look at that, right on the chin. Hatton's hands down again, and he's finding the holes in the defense of Hatton.
Well, we said this was the litmus test, the barometer tonight of Hatton, and many times we've mentioned about him getting hit too much and maybe paying the penalty when he moved up in class, and that's happened. And there's another right hand. We thought it would be the McGee left that would be the problem, but they've been working, haven't they, on this right hand, because Hatton does leave his left glove low. It's low now.
Yeah, always, you know, that's the shot that we've said Hatton has been open to. McGee with a southpaw stance, teeing off with that counterpunch very well.
But Hatton will still believe he can break down Eamon McGee.
Well, good fighters come through bad spells. Good fighters go down, get up and win. This is what Hatton's got to try and do.
But being a little more circumspect, notably Hatton here. I think the answer for him is in and out, isn't it? Not hang around too long in there.
Yeah, he's trying a bit too hard early on. He's got a point to prove. Billy Graham's told him, you know, just hang off a little bit, take your time.
Now that's a bit better from Hatton. He said he might have some problems early. He's watched a lot of videos of McGee. He said he really couldn't see that much, really, to lose sleep over. He might have to reassess that. Right hand was a good shot from Hatton. McGee has always had very good resilience. Hatton number three with the WBC and McGee number four. More realistically, 8 and 17 on the independent rankings.
Still McGee waits for Hatton to come in. Hatton duly obliges.
There's another little counter from McGee, but he's still caught by that left of the body. It seemed to go around the back. It shouldn't be a scoring punch. Hatton's having to use his boxing brain a little here. He's going to have to do more than just charge in. And we're seeing in and out tactics. This is a bit smarter from Hatton. Change of ploy.
The mark of a good fighter to come back like this. He's doing well, getting a nice rhythm, more thoughtful work from Hatton now.
It was noticeable McGee waved him in there. A sign maybe that McGee is less happy with what Hatton is doing now, because he's giving him less chance to go for the counters. There he goes for that big right again. Hatton's got to watch it. He could be taken out with one of these. He really could. There are danger signals flashing. He must not be too gung-ho, Hatton, otherwise he could pay a very, very big price. Welcome back to a packed MEN arena in Manchester. A tumultuous atmosphere here for one of the big domestic showdowns of recent years. McGee must be happy with the way things are going, though. I think he was outworked in that last round.
Yeah, I think he just waited a bit too long. That's something he can't afford to do. He's got to keep a good work rate up, but he is a counter-puncher.
This is one of the favourite rounds of Hatton for finishing his fight, so he'll do well to finish off this fella at any time. A more circumspect Ricky Hatton, more head movement from him there, but always the danger that he's going to be tagged by a right hand again. It would be a massive blow to this huge crowd here in Manchester, who have really got behind Hatton, who's cut. He's got a cut. There's blood around there. Trying to see how bad that is. That'll lift McGee as they work in close. A good uppercut on the inside from the Irishman.
See, Hatton doesn't really want to be in there. That's no good for him. You know, the heads come together. He can't get his work going properly.
It's so often the way you get a cut for a clash of heads when you get an orthodox fighter and a southpaw. You thought it would happen, didn't you, Glenn?
Yep, it's always the case. You know, both lead arms are together. Heads often clash in.
Having said that, Hatton is used to the problem. He's got a very good cut man in the corner. He had to fight virtually the whole fight when he won the British title against John Thaxton with a terrible, terrible cut. Gets it with a body shot. Was McGee a little more troubled than he has been so far by one of those? It seemed that way. We think that a punch caused the cut.
Yep, I think it was that long left hand that did it. McGee so sharp when Hatton tries to come in. Hatton's really having to think here.
McGee's strategy based on fast, hard counter-punching. And it's setting Ricky Hatton huge problems. If you could devise a style, really, to beat Hatton, probably this would be it.
Well, McGee isn't moving a lot, so he can stand there, he can set his legs, he can get power in his punches.
Again, a sharp left, but Hatton comes back. Good right hand to the head from him.
But that eye is getting noticeably worse, Ian, and that was a good left hand to the eye.
There's that left hook to the body and the right hand to the head again from Hatton. Mickey Van steps in. We've got a timeout. I think he's worried about too much coaching from the corner by the look of it from McGee's people. Come on in again, says McGee. I love this. I love counter-punching.
Well, he does look pretty happy where he's at, right in his own corner.
And he's going for huge haymakers. One of these lands, I think Ricky Hatton is going to land out in Manchester Piccadilly Station.
But he's catching good shots, McGee. He's managing to come back with these counters that are landing, and that was McGee's round for me.
Don't be too eager, Ricky. Being too eager to give too many chances. Does he feel like he's wilting the touch yet? Is he weakening the touch yet?
I think it's a harder fight, I think, than Ricky Hatton imagined it was going to be.
Yep, I think it is. He's been very casual about it. He thinks McGee's one-dimensional. He's finding out he's got a little bit more to him and McGee than just that. He can do a lot of things, but what he's doing is he's fighting his fight.
Definitely a punch that caused the cut. That's the one we think did it, that little right hand there. Doesn't look too bad, does it?
No, it's not in a bad place. It's under the eye, but the eye's swelling a little bit.
Well, Paxton was saying, everyone says my style suits him, that's rubbish. But I'm afraid it isn't. Fifth round. Clever performance so far by Eamon McGee. Can he sustain it? The hand speed is troubling Hatton, whose defence isn't quite tight enough as well.
Well, he's having to lead off, isn't he, Hatton? He's having to come forward. McGee, you know, he's controlling it in his own mind. He's getting Hatton to do what he wants Hatton to do.
That body shot did have an effect on McGee, who breathed quite heavily as he came off the ropes. But he's not getting in as many of those kind of shots than he normally does happen tonight. Undoubtedly, this is the hardest test of his career. We thought it would be. Now, can he find a way to prevail? Or will McGee, as he promised, cause the upset and burst the bubble? Just pulling him onto the punches, little warning for McGee.
McGee having almost an argument with Mickey Van in that corner there.
Body shots, good ones from Hatton. Just seemed to want to buy a little time for a moment there, didn't he, McGee? But all the time, he's thinking and calculating and waiting for the counter. just like a cunning fox. He's setting a trap and almost saying to Hatton, come on in and see what happens. Oh, that's better from Hatton. Vicious looking left hook into the side of the head of McGee.
Yep, that was a nice clean shot, some short chopping shots from Hatton. Better work from Hatton. McGee's not getting off.
A bit more pressure. I think if Hatton thinks if he can get in close enough and really lay on him, he'll deny McGee leverage for any counters. Good idea, Glenn?
Well, it's working at this point, but he's also denying himself the room to get his shots on and also making it easier to get cut with the heads.
But I think he figured he had to start getting in with some shots to start making a dent in McGee for the long-term plan of breaking him down. But he's thinking all the time, Hatton, and looking to get away again. He does not want to stay around in there too long.
Nice body shot with the right hand from Hatton. A little bit more success in this round.
A compelling strategic battle between these two. Exciting too. A very, very absorbing fight here. Ricky Hatton has landed 36 punches to 7 to the body, but that does not begin to tell the story of this fight.
No, it doesn't at all. There's some little shots inside, landing to the body, some good ones as well from Hatton, but the good solid shots and the good work is often coming from McGee.
Down for the first time in his pro career in the first round of this fight. Now then, McGee, who was hanging around almost on the same square foot of canvas for round after round, has gone on his bike, and it brought ironic applause from the Manchester fans here. Now that's a sign maybe though that McGee doesn't want to be taking too many of these body shots from Hatton and feels he needs to try something a bit different.
Well, his work with back to the ropes was working. It's what he's gonna do now. When he moves about, he can't set his feet as much, McGee, so the power will not be there quite as well as it was.
There he is, going for that right hand again, missing this time. But there are red lights flashing. I think all the time McGee is in this fight, he's dangerous. Raiding tactics by Hatton. Going for it again. I think they think, the McGee camp, that Hatton's defence is a bit leaky and they can get lucky with one of these.
Yeah, well, they've got to rely on something else and just get lucky. They've got to keep the shots going in. He's got to try and catch Hatton with something else. Good work from Hatton there.
That one definitely registered on the Richter scale, the body shot. It brought a kind of cynical smile from McGee. There's another one. He just came up for air a little, didn't he, after it landed, McGee. Off balance, more than anything, as the jab caught him.
Now Hatton's starting to settle in. This is more like the sort of work he wants. McGee moving, is shooting Hatton more, coming forward.
Hatton has had to come through crises in rounds 1 and 2. Is he just taking over? Is McGee just waiting his time to land another concussive shot? At the moment, and I stress at the moment, Hatton having the better of the argument. I should think his fans and his family are absolute nervous wrecks watching this.
And Hatton getting into a bit more of a rhythm now, starting to let more and more shots go, and more shots